Hi, it's Carly McAvoy. In this video, I'm talking about estimating a population proportion and also talking about confidence intervals and confidence levels. And so there's a lot of vocabulary. In the following videos, we'll do some examples that might make those a little more clear, but I need to get the definitions out there for now. A point estimate is a single value or point used to approximate a population parameter. Say population parameter because we could be talking about proportion or mean or standard deviation. In this particular section, we're talking about proportion. And so we use a sample proportion as the best point estimate for a population proportion because we saw before, earlier, proportions are unbiased estimators. We can use proportions to build a confidence interval that estimates the true value of the population proportion. And we should know the sample size in order to do this. And so p hat is our sample proportion. And that's equal to the number of successes over the number of trials for our particular problem, x over n. That is the percent success. A confidence interval is a range of values used to estimate the true value of a population parameter. So we give basically an interval, like from 0 to 10, and we're pretty sure that the actual true proportion is within this interval, right? So, for instance, a study finds a confidence interval of 0.35 up to 0.63. So the probability, and we don't have a hat on it, that means the probability for the population is between 35% and 65% with the confidence level of 95%. So these are all vocabulary and terminology things that I was talking about. What that means is they're 95% confident that the interval between 0.35 and 0.63 contains the true value of the proportion for the population. That's what that means. It means we're 95% confident that we've captured an interval that contains the actual value. A confidence level is the probability that the confidence interval actually does contain that population parameter. The example we just saw was a 95%, but we can also use 90, 95, 99. We can use anything, but these are the most common ones. In fact, 95 is the most common of all. When we're talking about confidence levels, we're talking about probabilities, which goes back to area under the curve that we saw in previous chapters. So if we're talking about 90% confidence, then that's the alpha 1 minus 0.9 or 0.10. In other words, if you look at this, 90% confidence means here's our range of values. These are the ones that are likely to occur, and these out here in the blue are the ones that are not likely to occur. If we're 90% confident, that means we have 10%, 5% in each tail where we think the unlikely values are. And so we can look at what is if there's 5% area to the left, what's the z value for that? And that would be negative. Typically, we talk about the critical value or the z value there as the positive value, but there's a positive or a negative there. And the mean under each tail is 0.5 or 0.05 because it's 10% altogether, but we divide it up into two parts. So we have this z is alpha over 2. That's because we're dividing that area into two parts under each tail. And so we have z a over 2, and that's plus or minus 1.645. Typically, we just say it's the positive one, but you can see that there's two values there. 95% confidence. How would you do that one? We would take 1 minus 0.95, get 0.05, and then we would use the inverse normal function on the calculator, or you can use StatCrunch. We've done this before where we say, if the area is this, what's the z-score? That's what you'd have to do to find that. But these 90, 95, and 99 are so common that I'm giving you those values now, and you can just, you don't have to look those up every time. You know what those values are going to be. If we have 95% likely to occur, then there's 2.5% on each end that are not likely to occur, because that's the 5% divided by 2, and then we have that under each tail. And the significant or the critical value for that is 1.96. 1.96 separates. That's the boundary that separates the likely to occur from the not likely to occur values. And finally, 99% confidence, we're doing the same thing, 1 minus 0.99, and then divide it by 2 because we're going to put that probability into the 2 tails. And then we can then go and use technology and say, if this area is 0.005, what is the z-score associated with that? And we get 2.576. So just taking a look at those all at once, you can see if you have 90% confidence, you're talking about the space in here. 95% confidence, you've got more values that you're confident about and fewer that you're not confident about. And 99%, even more extreme, we're confident about 99% of the values, and there's only 1% divided into 2 parts at the ends that we're not comfortable about. So the z-scores with confidence levels are called critical values because they are the values that separate the z-scores that are significantly high or low from the non-significant scores. These critical values are denoted by z alpha over 2. Alpha is the area or probability containing significantly high or low z-scores. And it's divided by 2 because there's 2 tails. And so here's the little quick wrap-up for that. For the confidence level 90%, that means we have 10% that we're not confident about, basically. 95, we have 5%, and 99, we have 1%. And the critical values are given here, and if you keep those with you, you don't have to calculate those every time. I wanted to show you one example before I go. A company wants to increase viewership from a study. They found that 42% of their viewers are watching a certain Netflix show. The true proportion is found to be 0.5. Given that information, they do 9 more studies and create 10 confidence levels. Here's their 10 confidence levels. What we can see is that 9 out of 10 of those intervals do contain the true proportion because the true proportion is here, and 9 out of 10 of theirs, all but this one, contain that true value. So you come up with an interval that contains the true value. Since they've got 9 out of 10, they're 90% confident that they're containing the correct value. What that means, what that tells them, is that their process that they're doing results in a confidence interval that contains the true proportion 90% of the time, which is pretty good. All right, we'll talk about margin of error in the next video coming up. Have a great day.